Hello everyone, Stepan here. I'll continue the series on the French defense with the Winawer variation, which is perhaps the most important variation for any player with black to know, and by far the most aggressive way for black to play the French defense. It occurs out of this position. This is the classical French, or the Paulsen French variation. After e4, e6, the French defense, d4, d5, white plays knight to c3. Other moves, of course, are knight to d2, the Terrasse French, e5, the advanced, or e takes d, which would be the exchange French defense. Sorry. But the Winawer, of course, out of the classical variation. And the Winawer defense is black playing bishop to b4 on move 3. This is now the Winawer French. And you can see that both sides are pretty much having the same issues they had in the other variations I have covered, and both sides have common French defense plans. Now black, of course, is aiming to disrupt white's central control with a break such as c5 or f6 in the future, and white will want to advance in the center, have more space on the kingside as well, and start a kingside attack. And the point of the move knight to c3 is to control the center, but accept the fact that it will be hard to defend the d4 pawn, and this will be the main theme of the opening in the first moves. Now white's most common continuation is the move e5. We will concentrate on that move first, and we will come back to the sidelines later in the video. After e5, black has several moves he could play. The most important and the most active move is c5, which is immediately breaking on the queenside, after which white is playing a3, which is chasing the bishop away. It could either take or return to a5, which would be the retreat variation of the Winawer. But after this, the most common line is bishop takes c3, b takes c3, and now knight to e7 by black. And this is, let's say, the starting position of the main line Winawer French. This could also occur out of the advanced French by transposition, but most commonly it will happen out of the Winawer. Now about the early moves. After bishop to b4, of course, white doesn't have to play e5, it's just the most sensible thing to do, so he is immediately gaining space and restraining normal development by black. You can see that the knight doesn't have the natural f6 square. You can see that white has much more space in the center, of course, and this move is also indirectly blocking out this bishop out of the game, because black has, of course, no option to play e5 himself, opening up the bishop on the diagonal. Secondly, black plays c5 in order to disrupt that central control immediately. This is the only way to play. There are some sidelines, but they have similarly aggressive positions. A3 is designed to relieve the pressure from the knight if the bishop should retreat, or to simply gain the bishop pair. Now after A3, retreating, as I said, would be an okay option for black. After this, black isn't worse or anything. It's just a different plan. And after this, white will most commonly continue with the move b4. And after c takes d4, which is black's most common line, attacking the knight in exchange for his bishop being attacked, knight to b5 will happen. And now, bishop to c7. And this variation, you can check out some games by Varuzian Akobian. He actually played the game fairly recently in this variation at the US Championship. I will link it in the description below. It's an interesting line, and this is a variation that not too many people with white will expect. But let's go back to the main position. After a3, so black could choose to retreat the bishop, but more active is to take on c3. And after c3, bishop takes c3, b takes c3, black is supposed to have equalized already, and he's supposed to have even a slight edge in this position. Of course, white's pawn structure is ruined, but that isn't as significant as it might seem. The main advantage of the pawn being on c3 is to reinforce the d4 pawn with the pawn and not with the piece, because d4 is the main weakness in white's camp, and usually black's entire strategy will focus around attacking d4 and increasing pressure. Now after knight to e7, black has, of course, allowed white a very active move, which white pretty much has to play, and that's the move queen to g4, and this is now the poisoned pawn variation of the Winawer French, and by far the most common variation, and the main line as well. And white here is attacking g7, of course, which gives black two options. One of the options is passive, and it will lead to a defensive game for black. And the other option is fairly aggressive, and it will lead to opposite sides castling and an aggressive game for black, so I would definitely advise the latter option. I'm going to show you the passive one first, and that would be for black to castle on move 7, simply defending the g7 pawn. But the problem is that after bishop to d3, knight b to c6, queen to h5, let's say pressurizing h7, knight to g6, knight to f3, you can see that black's entire play is defensive. Of course, he is simply trying to survive. Not that black is worse. if you ask the engines, the position is completely equal, but you can, if somebody asked you which color is attacking here, everybody would say white, and black doesn't really have anything in the attack yet. Of course, he has a structural advantage because white has double c-pawns, but he also has a positional disadvantage because his bishop on c8 is still dead. However, this position is perfectly playable for black, and after, let's say, queen to c7, preparing to open up the position, bishop e3, c4 could be another way to play. You could close the position down immediately. Now, bishop takes g6 would be the most active, f takes, queen to g4. The position is of course playable, however black doesn't have that much in the attack. You can even exchange the queens and by pressuring the c2 pawn and have some ideas like that, but it's definitely not a way to play if you are trying to win. So I would like to advise you not to go for this line, after queen to g4 not to castle, even though it's the most sensible move. It's very hard to win that position for black. A much more active move and accepting the pawn sacrifice is queen to c7. And this is simply giving away the g7 pawn for a lot of activity. And this is the main line, the most common line of the Winawer French. After queen takes g7, of course, rook to g8, queen takes h7, and now you play c takes d4. In this position, of course, if white takes with c takes d4, then he's losing a rook. Queen to c3 check, king d1, queen takes a1, so that doesn't work. So after c takes d4, white has two main options. The most common move is knight to e2, simply defending this threat and not allowing you to capture on c3. You continue with knight b to c6, f4 is the most common idea for white, gaining initiative on the king side and gaining counterplay on the king side. D takes c3. Knight takes c3. Now you could try knight takes c5, it would work, of course, because if f takes e5, then queen takes knight, but white would have the move knight to b5, and after queen to b8, of course, the knight still can't be taken because you have this check here and you pick up the rook, and the position is pretty much better for white, but black stands okay. However, after knight takes c3, a much better choice is to play a6 first, defending from knight to b5, and now all of your options are open and you have very active play. Of course, you might not even castle in this variation. The king might stay stuck in the center, but that's perfectly okay because it's actually defending by these two pawns and by the knights in this line. After c takes d4, white could play knight to e2. The second most common move is king to d1. However, this already gives black a slight advantage. And I would advise you to play knight b to c6. And white's most common idea will be to pressure f7, to pressure the f7 pawn. So after knight to f3, d takes c3, knight to g5. You can see that this pawn is now almost indefensible. You can defend it with knight to f5, I'm sorry. You can defend it with knight takes e5. However, in almost all lines, the pawn is going to drop. Let's say knight takes e5, f4 chasing the knight away. You would have to play f6 counterattacking white's knight, and after f takes e5, f takes g5, queen to h5 check, king to d7, black is equal. However, not that many attacking chances in this line. So after knight to g5, the more active line, which is, if you ask the engines, unwise for black to play, is to take with the queen. Queen takes. Now, of course, you allow this check, but that doesn't really do anything, because after king to d7, black's king is perfectly safe, and you have a lot of attacking play. You can see that white's king is misplaced. You are going to get all of your pieces into the attack. You are going to play b6, bishop to b7, and activate on this diagonal, and black stands much better here, practically. So this would be the main poison pawn variation of the Winawer French. So after queen to g4, you can either castle or you can play queen to c7. If you're trying to win, always go for queen to c7. And remember this forcing line, this will happen in every single game. C takes d4, remember that white can't take. And remember that he can either play knight to e2 or king to d1. If he plays king to d1, you are already better after knight bc6, knight to b3, knight to f3, dc3. Knight to g5, you can let go of the pawn, take with the queen, and have an active game. So this is a very good line. And if you do decide to castle, just try to defend as fast as possible and as good as possible. Of course, you do have counterplay on the queen side. However, it's much harder to materialize any attack for black. Okay, this was the main line. This was the poison pawn variation. Now, let's go back to this position. After bishop to b4, we just went through e5 and c5, I'm sorry, which is the main response for black on move 5. I would just like to go over a few sidelines before we go on to white sidelines on move 4. After e5, black can play a few more moves. A very nice way to play and to change the move order, which could lead to your advantage, is the move knight to e7. And this is, of course, you still haven't played c5, you might not play it at all. And in fact, if white goes for normal lines such as a3 and you take on c3, white takes on c3, you can play c5 now. You can decide to transpose to the same position, and you most probably will. This is the main line that we just saw. However, after knight to e7, white doesn't have to play the move a3. He might be confused after you didn't play c5, and he might play bishop to d2. And after that, after b6, you have changed the position completely, and you have gained the possibility to get rid of your bad bishop immediately, because there's no way for white to stop a trade of pieces. And after knight takes a6, you can play c5 and then take with the knight if white takes. If he doesn't, you can take on d4 and then play knight to c5. So this is a very nice sideline for black to remember. After the move e5, you don't have to play c5, try knight to e7. And depending on what white does, you can have a playable position which is out of the ordinary, different than the main line. And there's another line. If white decides to play queen to g4 here immediately, that could become very risky for him. Here you do play c5. And now, of course, it's not possible to take the pawn on g7 and to stay. Well, okay, he could take now, queen takes g7. And let's say rook to g8, queen takes h7. Now you take on on d4. And now a3 doesn't work. That's where white could go badly wrong. Of course, you have now grabbed the pawn for nothing, and black stands better here. Because after a3, you always have the move queen to a5, pinning the pawn to the rook. The knight is now lost, of course, and you stand much better. The same thing would happen if after c5, black wouldn't take the pawn, but he would play, white wouldn't take the pawn, sorry, but he would play a3 immediately, then once again queen to a5 works. And this is a great line to try out. So knight to e7 on move 4 by black is a great way to avoid the mainline theory, and you are giving white some options to go wrong. Another idea that you could go for after e5 is the move b6. And once again, this is getting out of the normal main lines. You aren't playing c5, you aren't playing knight to e7. Both of these moves will most probably be played anyway. However, you are preparing to develop your bishop and to trade it off for white's bishop. And this is resolving the main problem of the French defense, the bad light squared bishop on c8. So b6 is another way to go. So, okay, after e5, the most common move is c5, getting into the poison pawn variation, the main line, but also try b6 and try knight to e7. These are very interesting sidelines. Now let's go back to this position, the position in which the Winawer French starts, bishop to b4. We just went over e5, the main response and the most active response for white. However, there are a few more lines that white could go for. Firstly, this is e takes d5. This is the delayed exchange variation. It doesn't offer that much to white. The position is perfectly equal and very boring. So after e takes d, bishop to d3, knight to c6, a3, bishop takes, b takes, knight g2, e7. It's a dry position in which white doesn't really have that much. He has doubled c pawns. Of course, they are easily liquidated with c4, but still, there's nothing much in the position. Black is going to castle kingside, white is going to castle kingside, black is going to play bishop to e6, white is playing knight to f3. Black has a weak e5 square, but that's the main weakness in his position, so nothing really that major. This is a line you could play with white, but I think it's much better to go for the main line. Another variation is knight to e2, and this is, I would say, the most interesting line, is the Alekha and Marozzi gambit. And if you would like to see this in more detail, I think Varuza Nakobian made a very detailed video for the St. Louis Chess Club about this whole variation. He goes on about it for about an hour, and it's very instructive, so I would advise you to watch that as well. I will just go over the variation briefly. The main point of this move, knight to e2, is to gambit the central pawn, and taking the pawn is the most challenging way for black to approach the variation. So first, of course, after knight to e2, you play d takes e4. After e3, after a3, bishop takes c3, knight takes c3, knight to c6. Defending the pawn immediately would be bad for black. If he tries f5 in this position, this would give a lot of activity to white, and he would be almost winning after the move f3, wrecking the position. You would have to take with e takes f3, queen takes f3. You can see that e6 is weak. You can see that your entire position is very loose, despite having an extra pawn, which doesn't really mean anything in this position. So after the move knight takes c3, you don't defend the pawn, you play knight to c6. And white doesn't really have time to take it. Of course, if in this position knight takes e4, then you simply take on d4 with the queen, so this isn't an option still. And after knight to c6, white will most commonly continue with the move bishop to b5, pinning the knight. Now you continue with knight to e7, reinforcing that. Now once again, taking here would be inadvisable. It wouldn't be such a good move, because once again, black would have too much activity. Let me just show you that variation. If knight takes c4 in this position, then queen to d5, attacking the bishop, attacking the knight, and you can see that, of course, the pieces can be defended. That doesn't mean anything. Of course, bishop can retreat to d3, but then queen takes d4, and once again, black stands much better. That's why after knight to e7 and bishop to, after knight to e7, reinforcing the knight, bishop to g5 is played, pinning the other knight, and in this position, black plays f6. Attacking the bishop, and after bishop to e3, castles. The main move for white here is queen to d2, and this is, let's say, the starting position of the Alekhine Morozzi gambit in the French Winawer, and it's a very exciting way for white to play. However, black is supposed to be better out of the opening, and white can't really prove the compensation for the pawn if black plays well. So remember that if white plays knight to e2, we have d takes e4, a3, bishop takes, knight takes, knight to c6. Remember to play knight to c6, never to play f5 early on defending the pawn. This would give white too much activity. And if you do play knight to c6, white can't regain the pawn anyway. So this is the Alekhine Morozzi gambit, a very exciting line. After bishop to b4, if not e takes d5, the delayed exchange, if not e5, the main line, or knight to e2, which would be the Alekhine Morozzi gambit, there are a few more lines that white could go for. Firstly, a3. This is the so-called Winkelmann-Reiner gambit, and it's also offering a central pawn, and it's a very nice way to surprise your opponent with black if he isn't prepared. Of course, here black should take, bishop takes e3, b takes e3, and now d takes e4, grabbing a pawn. And this will lead to positions similar to the poisoned pawn variation. After queen to g4, attacking g7, you play knight to f6, queen takes rook g8, queen to h6, and now rook to g6 could be played for another tempo, and after queen to d2, you play b6. Preparing to fianchetto your light squared bishop, you basically got rid of your main weakness in the position. The material situation is even. Both sides have wrecked pawn structures and unsafe kings, so this will lead to exciting games every time. So as white, if you want to surprise your opponent, play a3. It's a very interesting line. Of course, you are at the moment you are giving up a pawn temporarily, but you will regain g7. Give black some activity, and both sides have a lot of stuff to play for, and it's a very interesting position for both colors. Now let's go back. After bishop to b4, there are two more passive variations you could go for. Firstly, bishop to d2. This is called the finger slip variation, and it used to be played by a lot of players in the past. I wouldn't say that's too challenging for white, too challenging for black, because normal continuation should be d takes e4, and after queen to g4 attacking g7, then simply queen takes d4 defending the g7 pawn, and it's supposed to be equal. However, after white castles, it's once again a very double-edged position which could lead to some exciting variations and exciting fighting games. So after bishop to d2, remember that this is not a passive move. It just doesn't give that much to white, practically speaking, but it could lead to a lot of excitement. If you are black, take on e4. So d takes e4, white will have to play queen to g4 to justify his position, and you take on d4 now. And after this, white will castle, and you can see that white gambited two pawns. Of course, he could have regained one immediately on e4, and he most probably will. However, your position is, as black, your position is seemingly very loose, and white has already castled, white has a lot of piece activity. So if you are white, remember, this line is a very aggressive way to fight the Winawer French, and actually a great surprise weapon. This is the fingerslip variation, so bishop to d2 on move 4. Another possibility is to play bishop to d3 on move 4, which is, I would say, the most passive, if not the delayed exchange. And this leads to some normal positions after d takes c4, bishop takes e4, knight to f6, gaining a tempo on the bishop, bishop f3. The difference is that this bishop is now designed to stop any plans the c8 bishop might have, so now black is going to have a hard time developing. And practically speaking, of course, that can be resolved easily. However, if you face it for the first time, you might feel uncomfortable. So you play c5 here, knight to e2, knight to c6, a3, bishop takes, b takes, e5. This is a very aggressive move that you have to remember. And of course, you have to exploit the fact that white's center is about to crumble. Castling would be okay, of course, slightly passive, but okay. But if you have the chance, break another time in the center. And e5 really can't be reacted to by d5. The best move would actually be to castle and to allow you to take. However, after d5, you can play e4, and now d takes c6, queen takes d1, king takes d1, e takes f3, g takes f3, and b takes c6. Black is equal, slightly better, because he has less structural weaknesses. White has two sets of double pawns. So yeah, this is the bishop to d3 line on move 4. So remember that after bishop to b4, the Winawer French, after you enter the Winawer, white could play e5, which is the main line. White could play e takes d5, which is delayed exchange variation. White could play a3, which is the Winkelmann-Reiner gambit. White could play knight to e2, which is the Alekhine-Marozzi gambit. White could play bishop to d2, which is the fingerslip variation. And white could play bishop to d3, which is a slightly passive line, which would lead to a seemingly equal position. So a lot of possibilities for white to respond to the Winawer. If you are playing this with black, be prepared. If you are playing this with white, prepare something to surprise your opponents, and good luck. I hope you got something out of this video and that you are more familiar with the variation now. Thanks very much for watching, and stay tuned for more chess. Thank you. Bye.